Very warm welcome to our viewers and welcome to this afternoon's edition of Africa Today, our program bringing all the latest news, making the headlines all around the African continent. And we start, of course, with the story of the hour, where Chad's president, Idriss Déby, has died whilst visiting troops on the front line of a fight against the northern rebels the day after he was declared the winner of the presidential elections. Déby, aged 68, came to power in a rebellion in the 1990s and was one of Africa's longest ruling leaders. His campaign manager said on Monday he was joining troops battling what he named terrorists after the rebels based across the northern frontier advanced hundreds of kilometers south towards the capital, N'Djamena. The cause of death has not yet been clarified. His election victory had given him a sixth term in office, but the April 11 vote was boycotted by the opposition leaders. And for more news, the Foreign Minister Sam Ashukri is continuing his six-nation African tour that includes Kenya, Comoros, South Africa, Senegal, DRC and Tunisia. On Monday, Shukri concluded his visit to Comoros, his second leg on the African tour. We have more details in this report.
Foreign Minister Issa Shukri on Monday handed a message from President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi to President of the Comoros Zali Assoumani to developments of the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam in a meeting in Moronyu. Shukri's visit to Comoros is his second stop in an African Six Nation tour that includes Dr. Congo, the current chair of the African Union, as well as Senegal, Tunisia, South Africa and Kenya. The tour that started with Kenya comes to brief the Six Nations on development of the GERD issue, including the latest AU-sponsored talks that took place in the Congolese capital of Kinshasa in April. President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi's message to Assoumani included a brief on the current situation of the GERD issue and the Egyptian stance in this regard. Shukri, during his meeting with Assoumani, reviewed the highlights of the Kinshasa talks. Shukri said that the recent talks highlighted Egypt's genuine political leadership to launch a serious negotiations path that results in reaching a legally binding agreement on the filing and operation of the dam. Shukri affirmed that this agreement should preserve the rights and interests of the three countries of Egypt, Ethiopia and Sudan. The minister also expressed Egypt's keenness to work with concerned nations and parties to reach a solution on the GERD dispute in a way that does not harm region security and stability. Shukri also said that Egypt is looking forward to developing the bilateral relations with Comoros in various fields and continuing coordination and consultation with the African country on regional and international issues of mutual concern.
For more news, the Cabinet's Media Center said on Monday that the Prime Minister, Mustafa Madbouly, heads on Tuesday a ministerial delegation to the Libyan capital, Tripoli, where he's expected to meet Libya's new leaders to discuss a number of political and economic issues. We have more details in the story.
Prime Minister Mustafa Madbouly embarks on Tuesday a historic visit to Libya for talks with the Northern African country's new leadership. The Prime Minister's visit to Libya will be the first trip by a top Egyptian official to the neighboring country in more than 10 years. The Cabinet Media Center said that Madbouly is expected to discuss economic and political cooperation, the return of Egyptian workers to Libya, and Egypt's participation in Libya's reconstruction. It added also that Madbouly will meet with his Libyan counterpart, Mohamed Adebeba, adding that the two sides will sign a number of economic agreements, including on the construction of several power plants by Egyptian Libya. Earlier, there were reports that Libyan Presidential Council head Mohamed Younes Menfi reached an agreement with Egyptian President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi on reopening the Egyptian embassy in Tripoli. Last month, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi affirmed Egypt's readiness to transfer its experience to the Libyan government in various fields. The President's remarks came as he received in Cairo on Thursday head of the Libyan Presidency Council Mohamed Menfi. The President said that these efforts, especially in the fields of security and police, aim to help the Libyan state restore national institutions and achieve security and stability. The President stressed Egypt's stance, aiming at achieving the supreme interest of the Libyan state at the first place.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, and we're delighted to be joined over the telephone by His Excellency Ambassador Hussein Hariri, the former Assistant to Foreign Minister. It's a very good afternoon to you, Mr. Ambassador.
Good afternoon, madam.
Thank you so much, sir, for joining us and for your time.
No, thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Now, the Prime Minister, Dr. Mustafa Madbouly, leads a top delegation to a visit in Libya. The first top official, really, to visit the country since the last 10 years or so. In your opinion, sir, the importance of this visit, especially with the large delegation that is accompanying the Prime Minister?
Well, it's a very good step forward. And it signals a new chapter in Egyptian-Libyan relations after 10 years, after a decade of turmoil, insecurity, and instability in Libya. Mm-hmm. Of course, this new chapter would see the relations between the, between the two countries strengthened. And of course, our security would be our national security will be one of the main issues that will be discussed, as well as the reopening of the Egyptian embassy in Tripoli and Libyan embassy in Cairo.
Right.
I guess with this visit, relations between Egypt are normalized, and the past is behind us, and we have to build both us and the Libyans. We have to build a very strong relationship for the future.
Absolutely. Mr. Ambassador, now Egypt has long really voiced its support unshakably really to Libya and its new leaders, the head of the Libyan Presidential Council, Prime Minister, etc. First of all, how have you followed the ongoing political processes in Libya?
Well, we are very hopeful that the what we call the Berlin process has borne fruit, and now we have a transitional political authority in Libya, a transitional government, plus the Presidential Council. And as you may recall, both the President of the Presidential Council and the Prime Minister of Libya paid a visit to Cairo. And both of them, on separate occasions, met with President el-Sisi.
Yes.
In his meetings with the two, President el-Sisi reaffirmed our attachment to the Berlin Declaration of January 2020. And in fact, Egypt hosted some meetings in the context of this process. For instance, we hosted the some meetings for the Joint Military Commission, what's known as the Commission of 5+5. And then, on the other hand, we also hosted some meetings for the Constitutional Committee that is tasked to either amend the Libyan Constitution or to come up with a new constitution. On the other hand, we are committed to support Libya in holding the elections, the general and presidential elections, scheduled for December 24th this year.
Yes.
So Egypt is wholly supportive of the political process. We are hand in hand with the international community. We respect, we honor Security Council Resolution 2510 of February 2020 that has enshrined the Berlin Declaration of January 2020.
Indeed. Mr. Ambassador, as you said, of course, Egypt has offered its ultimate support to help Libya rebuild and build its institutions. In your opinion, sir, what are the entities that are priority, really, for the Libyans at the moment?
Well, of course, it's generally speaking, it's up to the Libyans to set their priorities. But of course, the absolute priority now is to prepare Libya for the next elections.
Yes.
As we said, they are supposed to take place in December this year. So this is an absolute priority. And as I understand the position of the Libyan government, they are working on this. The second thing, the second priority is to fulfill the ceasefire agreement of October 2020. And specifically, the dismantling of the militias,
yes,
which has remained a thorny problem from a security and political point of view, and secondly, the withdrawal of militias and mercenaries
yes.
that were deployed in Libya in the last few years. So, and of course, then according to the political agreement reached between the Libyans themselves, the unification of the state institutions, they have enumerated the seven institutions, among which figure the central bank, the army, and the administrative control agencies, the agency tasked with fighting corruption. So these are the priorities that the transitional authority in Libya is working on.
Yes, indeed. Right. How, in your opinion, Mr. Ambassador, can Egypt extend its hand to Libya in the crucial issue of security as well as police order for the country really to restore its stability, which is very central to Egypt's as well?
Well, of course, the success of the Libyan transitional government in unifying the army would be a great step towards securing the joint Egyptian-Libyan borders. Secondly, one political authority, a powerful central state after the December elections would be really another element, another factor in securing our borders with Libya and fighting terrorism within Libya. So I think Libya is on the right track now.
Yes.
And Egypt is wholly supportive of all the decisions and the steps and the measures that the Libyan Transitional Authority would take in the next few months in order to put Libya on the right track of transiting to democracy.
Absolutely. Mr. Ambassador, we've heard several times President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi saying that building a strong Libyan national army should be a priority to really help the country through this transitional period. How do you see this, and do you see this as possible and their role in removing, we're talking over 20,000 foreign fighters in the country?
Well, as we said earlier, madam, these are goals and objectives that must be fulfilled according to the ceasefire agreement of last October among the former National Accord government and the government in Benghazi. And I guess the international community, the Security Council, have called on the Libyan transitional government, transitional authority to carry out these agreements.
Yes.
Definitely, the unification of the armed forces, if I may use this term, to describe what's going on in Libya as far as armed forces are concerned. Of course, the unification is of utmost importance.
Yes.
And it's an aspect of a strong state that one condition to realize this is to dismantle the militias. Libya needs to dismantle the militias.
Yes.
To integrate some of them into the army and to integrate the others into the security forces, the domestic security forces, and to find subs for the remainder. These militias are paid on a monthly basis, and the Libyan government should be able to offer them an alternative.
Right. Mr. Ambassador, in your opinion, sir, what would be the perfect timing to, you know, lift the arms embargo on Libya, and how do you see the country defending itself in the face of foreign fighters if it is short on arms?
Well, I guess, as you may know, madam, the arms embargo was imposed on Libya in March 2011. and it has remained in effect due to the insecurity and instability within Libya. My impression that once there is a unified, centralized political authority after the elections of next December, I guess the Security Council would look into ending this embargo.
Right. Mr. Ambassador, today's delegation accompanying the Prime Minister includes the Ministers of Electricity, Petroleum, Manpower, Education, International Cooperation, Health, amongst many others, as well as trade. How do you see this visit as well geared towards somehow assisting with rebuilding several areas in the Libyan communities and societies, especially related as well to the Libyan economy?
Well, one of the challenges and the competition now is who would participate in the reconstruction efforts of Libya in the next few months, because it's a bonanza. We are talking about billions and billions, billions of U.S. dollars. And we, historically speaking, the Egyptian workforce has played an important role in the reconstruction in Libya. And even during the years of upheaval in Libya in the last decade, hundreds of thousands of Egyptians still work there. And having said that, we remember with respect the martyrs of the Egyptians that were assassinated in cold blood by the terrorist organization known as Daesh. So I guess the visit by the official visit by the Prime Minister, Dr. Madbouly, to Libya today would open really many opportunities for one, and which is very important, Egyptian labor to work in the reconstruction efforts in Libya, and secondly, for Egyptian companies, whether public sector companies or private sector, really to participate, to compete in tenders, and hopefully they would have a part of the big Libyan reconstruction cake. Historically speaking, Egyptians really helped significantly in rebuilding Libya, reconstructing Libya after before 1969 and after 1969.
And this seems to be again the intention of such a big delegation to speak and discuss.
Definitely it won't be easy, madam, but because there will be a fierce regional and international competition, and it will be I imagine that what Charles, the great scientist Charles Darwin, said, it will be the survival of the fittest. So let's hope that Egyptian companies would prove efficient, economic, hardworking, because they would meet very stiff competition from other regional and European companies.
Indeed. Finally, Mr. Ambassador, one final question, please. Through your observations, do you see the Libyan factions and warring sides on board to really reach the deadline of the December elections?
Well, they must, madam. The Security Council, the five permanent members of the Security Council, the international community as a whole is holding the and transitional authority accountable for holding these elections, and the European Union and as well as the Security Council have on several occasions made it clear to the Libyans that they have to work for the withdrawal of mercenaries, the dismantling of militias, and the unification of the state institutions like the army and the central bank and other agencies, administrative agencies. Mm-hmm. So I guess the Libyans, the Libyan people and the Libyan transition government, if it wants to succeed in its mission, they have to meet this date of holding the elections on December 24th this year.
Yes.
And the international community has promised to lend a hand to support the Libyan government in its efforts towards this goal.
Absolutely right. I'd like to thank you very, very much, Mr. Ambassador Hussein Hadidi, the former assistant to foreign minister. Thank you so much, sir, for your time and your insight. And that's all the time we have for today's edition of Africa Today. You were in the company of myself, Angie Meher. Many thanks for watching.